I'm Chad Rudenbow. I'm a former police officer and counter-drug and some counter-terrorism as well. I'm here to talk to you about surveillance detection. Surveillance is a very important part of interdicting any kind of criminal or terrorist activities. And when you are interacting with these people or dealing with law enforcement, you're going to need to be able to have a sense of what information to gather and how to report it to the correct authorities. So when you're using these things, how do you go about training your people to correctly identify surveillance? Is that something that you use day to day in Raven Security, or is it?
Yes, it is. When I check and search into the people, yes, I use, yes.
Great. Well, this should be just perfect, right up your alley for the training and for your folks, and we'll get to it. The goal of this course is to provide you with an awareness of the most common types of surveillance and the proactive measures that you can take to interdict those. We're going to want you to be able to identify the methods of conducting the surveillance, explain the attack cycle, discuss the difference between a hard target and a soft target, and then explain the choke point. When you are dealing with these folks, you're going to need to be able to describe them, the vehicles that they're driving, the techniques that they're using, and what to do if you suspect that you're under surveillance. How to avoid that, and then how to explain the attack recognition and response. Surveillance is generally to secure information. Whether it's an intelligence service, whether a criminal is looking to gain financial information, or a terrorist is looking to attack a target or create havoc. This is the attack cycle. There are other smaller things that go inside, but this is kind of how we look at things. So when you are initially starting something, they're going to identify the target. They're going to identify what they want to have happen. And they begin their initial planning and create that target list. They'll conduct surveillance and begin to gather the information. That surveillance then becomes active, and they're around the target, around the people that they're targeting, and then they'll begin to rehearse. After that comes the attack, which we hope we never get there, and then they're going to deal with the escape and exploiting the attack. When they're looking at selecting a target, whether it is a person or whether it's a group or whether it's an event or a facility, they're going to be looking at whether the target is high profile, low profile, and then the vulnerability of it. The higher the profile and the more vulnerable it is, the more that it is a desirable target. Definitely want something that's going to make a big splash in the media. It's going to be a higher profile target, gain a lot of attention. And the more vulnerable it is, the easier it is to attack. This is where you want to be unpredictable. The time and the place, the security measures, the security personnel, what kind of procedures and policies they have in place, what the response times are, the medical response times, and how well it's covered by the media. Those are all very important things. One of the things that are very important is the time aspects of an attack. So this is more about interdicting the surveillance.
Right, how to make yourself, you're trying to make yourself less vulnerable. And so one of the ways that you can harden yourself, people think I'm gonna harden it with a wall and a fence. But in this case, one of the easy ways is time, right? Hard versus soft.
I guess we'll start there. So hard target versus soft target. There are important distinctions between whether you're protecting a hard target like a facility or a soft target like personnel, somebody who's moving from place to place. Different ways to interdict the surveillance and interdict the attack on the attack cycle. So the most important thing is to be unpredictable when you are in your routines. So if you have a certain place that you go to every day, like work, and you leave at a certain time and you arrive at a certain time, do you take the exact same route? Do you vary the time that you leave? Do you vary the amount of time that it takes you to get there? That would be a very key component to disrupting that cycle on a soft target. Maybe look at a different work schedule if you want to make sure that that target is not going to be a viable target. And then maybe vary your work schedule or the time that you leave by 30 to 60 minutes. And the location is well suited for surveillance and the ability to blend into the environment. Is there a coffee shop right there at that corner that you can watch every day, and you watch that target go by, have to stop, get stuck in traffic, wait for 20 minutes, like I-5?
Middle East Asia, okay? They do a lot of IED, you know, they make the bomb, and then they are looking for the many people gathering, you know, like the checkpoint or at the coffee shop or more, something like that.
Yep.
How can Egypt to find out the suspicion, you know, people? Do you have any idea?
As you look at the different targets that are in your area, and especially for security personnel, when you're looking to decide what are the specific targets that are the best targets for bad guys to attack, whether it's a criminal organization or terrorists, you want to look for the most, unfortunate to say it, but the most casualties, the most news gathering targets that would make a big splash in the media, because that's what they want. They want to create awareness of their cause and bring fear and terror. That's why they're called terrorists. So when you're looking at something like a coffee shop or a choke point or even a checkpoint, that you're looking at something that has a certain set of vulnerabilities, a certain set of escape and surveillance opportunities and different things. So that's where you'll look at surveillance detection more closely on a hard target, on a fixed target, not something that's moving. So that's where you're looking for someone who is there every day, and they maybe shouldn't be. They're sitting in a car with the window up and videotaping, dark glasses. As soon as you see them and they see you, they hide their face. They drive away, they run away. They're measuring things. They're watching and doing attempts where they will call in a bomb threat and see who responds, how fast they respond, and what happens after that.
Those
are the kind of things to interdict.
Okay, one more thing. This is not PI, security. If the call the 911, can you explain a little about the this, you know, when contact the 911, going through, you know, the system, something?
Yeah, absolutely. So from a local law enforcement standpoint, if something is happening, like surveillance, or you have a suspicious activity that's happening, then a really great way to make sure that it gets documented to that location is to call 911, call the local law enforcement, make sure that it gets to the correct jurisdiction, the correct law enforcement office, and make a report. Even if it's just something that the hair on the back of your neck stands up and you think something's wrong about this, but you can't really articulate it, just say, hey, I'm just calling in to let you know that there was a man sitting in a car taking pictures of this place and it was weird. And they'll say, why was it weird? And then you think, well, maybe, you know, he had dark glasses on and it was nighttime. He had his window rolled up, you know. It's those kind of things that take it from a normal person taking a selfie to somebody doing something suspicious that then can lead to a criminal report or some sort of intelligence report. So if you do that and then later on a neighbor sees something and reports it, And later on, a police officer makes a weird contact with somebody. They'll all be categorized by that location. And it gives intelligence groups and local detectives and the folks that are in charge of putting those things together a group of information that leads them to be able to go in, interdict, and stop the next time that something's happening, or maybe stop an attack. So, great question.
Thank you for the answer to that.
So most people know a vehicle search. They're used to a vehicle search. But what we're going to teach is two types of vehicle searches in a potential explosive environment, right? So we're going to look a little bit more based on lessons learned from the Middle East and from Southeast Asia. Now, some things that we like to do on searches, of course, is you want a good pair of gloves because there can be sharp objects. You're going to be reaching under things and pulling things. So a good pair of gloves that both protect your hands and you can still feel. I want to be able to feel, but I don't want something sharp to cut through. So you'll have to come up with good gloves that feel right, but allow you to have some sensation of feeling, but without getting cut. And these are good for also person search, because sometimes, drug needles, knives, you'll get stabbed. So you want some protection. And even in daylight, use a good flashlight. And the reason is because the vehicle has a lot of dark areas that you can't really see. Also, with the sun coming down, it creates the shadows. So we want to be able to see inside the shadows. So always have a good flashlight. What I like to, sometimes you can get the headlights. You put the little lights in the head.
Headband the light.
Exactly, because wherever I'm looking, there's where the light is. If I want to use both hands, the headlight's good. And then sometimes, they even make these things, right? Which has the little headlight in there.
Oh.
See? So wherever I'm looking, so I can use my hands and I can move things, but I've still got the light.
I see.
And some guys like the little light you can put on here on the bill. So, but definitely have a light, and I like to have two. Because if one runs out, you want the other one. The other piece of equipment we don't have here, but you should have, is a mirror. Okay. And with mirrors, if you can, the big rectangular mirrors, the round mirrors, you lose a lot of definition.
Oh, really?
It's easier to see. You see more with the rectangular big mirror.
Oh.
Right? Okay. The other thing with a bigger mirror is it reflects more light, and you'll be able to see more in darker areas underneath. So a small mirror, you're going to miss a lot. A big mirror is great. And if you can get the light on the mirror that shines up, even better, right? Because I'm looking at the light underneath and I'm doing it that way. So those are the benefits. So the first thing that you want to do is, if the car is occupied or unoccupied. Okay. If there's an occupant at the car and you're doing a checkpoint operation or a vehicle stop operation, the very first thing that you have to do is you control their hands. So if we could have our volunteer Chad, the driver over here.
Okay.
So what he's going to do is he's going to simulate the driver in the car. And then the difference between a regular stop and a high threat stop is a high threat stop, we want the door open. I want to see everything in there. And the first thing I do when I come up on the back, I'm always coming up on the back side, is I'm looking at his hands, making sure he's not going to hit a switch. I'm looking for, look at that. Do the Chad thing, put the gun top looking down. Right, you can put your gun here. But I'm looking at his hands. I want to make sure they're on the wheel. They're not reaching for a weapon. They're not reaching for a switch. I'm looking for wires, any wires that are connected from the battery into the explosives in the back. Because a lot of times they'll run a wire from the battery to the explosive payload in the back. So I'm looking for those as I come up. And then I'll ask, I'll look in the door, has there been any modifications? Has there been any panels moved out? Right? How seamless is everything? Because sometimes, like we talked before, they'll hide explosives in here, right? And they'll take these off to put the explosives in. When they put it back, they don't do a good job sometimes. So I'm taking account of all this as I look, as I move up. And then when I ask him to exit the vehicle, again, watch his hands. Leave the keys in the vehicle. Please exit with your hands visible at all times, sir. There you go. Now, the reason we leave the keys in the vehicle is they have moved the key fobs to explosives, right? And what you need is a partner at this point. And they're gonna take away, make sure he does not work his cell phone, because a phone can activate the device. He doesn't use a radio. A radio can activate a device. A key fob can activate a device. So making sure he doesn't have those, and if you have a checkpoint, it's good to have a collection station. They can put everything in that collection station and then go back in, because I don't want him waiting for that moment. And then he reaches in, he pulls it out, boom, blows it up, right? So that's how you screen the person out. That's a difference in a normal traffic stop, because any electronic device you can kill. Now, if the engine engine is running, mm-hmm. don't turn the engine off. Leave the engine on.
Uh-huh.
Don't change the condition.
Why not turn it?
Because if they've surveilled you, they may know that you turn it off.
Oh.
And I can make a bomb. If I turn it off, it blows up. That's happened before. You turn off a light, you turn something off. Mm-hmm. You don't want to change the condition. Leave mm-hmm. the conditions as much as you can normally, mm-hmm. right? If the engine is off, okay. You can take the key out, adapt, mm-hmm. but realize if you push a button on the keychain, mm-hmm. you may activate the device.
Oh.
Anything you change might activate a device. Mm-hmm. So just be aware of that. Mm-hmm. The other thing when you're searching, and come around here, sir.
Okay.
The other thing when you're searching mm-hmm. is it's, and this is for anything.
Mm-hmm.
You want to change your angle of view
mm-hmm.
and change the angle of light.
Mm-hmm.
So by changing those two things mm-hmm. as I go around, mm-hmm. you increase your chances of detecting mm-hmm. something.
Okay.
So if I'm looking at the wheel mm-hmm. and I just do this,
mm-hmm. no, I'm good.
Gone. Mm-hmm. I haven't really searched it.
Uh-huh.
Because I can't see everything behind here. I'm only seeing what mm-hmm. this angle
yeah,
will show. Mm-hmm. So what I do is I change two things.
Mm-hmm.
I want to look
mm-hmm.
and I want to get as much of a 360 on this as I can.
Mm-hmm.
If I have a mirror, I put a mirror back here
mm-hmm.
and I'm moving the mirror around, not just one position,
mm-hmm.
minimum three positions if I can,
mm-hmm.
right? And with my light, mm-hmm. I'm going to bounce it off the mirror
mm-hmm.
or I'm going to illuminate down below
mm-hmm.
to try to get light into there. So you can bounce the light off the mirror
mm-hmm.
and then see it down.
Mm-hmm.
And I move two things.
Okay.
So the one thing is my head.
Mm-hmm.
I'm moving it, I'm looking, I'm hitting, I'm changing angles everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Even if I'm looking at one spot,
mm-hmm.
I'm gonna look at it like this,
mm-hmm.
and I'm gonna look at it like this,
mm-hmm.
because I may see something different.
Okay, change it to the angle and
always,
keep watching.
Exactly, change uh-huh. the angle, change the angle.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I'm looking at one spot, I'm changing the angle. If they're mm-hmm. good, you're gonna change the angle.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing is with your light,
because mm-hmm.
I can't get my head in there all the way.
Mm-hmm.
But with my light,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to also change the angle of the light.
Mm-hmm.
Because see, light creates shadow.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to eliminate the shadow. So wherever I'm beaming it right now,
mm-hmm.
I see where the shadow is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to move the light so there's no more shadow.
Okay.
And then I'm going to change my angle so I can see in there.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to move it and I know where the shadows are.
Mm-hmm.
And I eliminate the shadows and then I can look in there where the shadow used to be.
Nice.
So those two techniques, very
mm-hmm.
simple,
mm-hmm.
but they'll help you with all your searches.
Okay.
So door frames and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as I said, in the vehicle,
mm-hmm.
you have to be careful. So the trunk, any empty space
mm-hmm.
Can be used.
Mm-hmm.
The spare tire, remember we saw mm-hmm. in the video last week, the spare tire.
Mm-hmm.
So always have a little metal metal hammer or mm-hmm. metal knife
mm-hmm.
that you can hit.
Mm-hmm.
So a tire,
mm-hmm.
hollow,
mm-hmm.
right? If you hit mm-hmm. that spare tire and it doesn't make that hollow sound,
mm-hmm.
maybe
something inside.
Exactly. Look for changes in the rims.
Mm-hmm.
Look for changes in the body paneling,
mm-hmm.
especially if they put it here.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see that they'll tear this out.
Okay, good space to hide.
Exactly, and then the panel sometimes won't be put all the way back on.
Mm-hmm.
Dirt, look for places that are clean that should be dirty.
Mm-hmm.
Look for places that are dirty that mm-hmm. should be clean.
Find out unusual.
Exactly, mm-hmm. exactly. The absence of the normal, the presence of the abnormal. So you're looking for a change,
mm-hmm.
wires moving back,
mm-hmm.
and then you're examining it. Mm-hmm. And don't be hesitant to actually lift up things and look at underneath.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing here. I've got space here.
Mm-hmm.
So you're gonna look here. You're gonna check here,
mm-hmm.
right? Not hitting
mm-hmm.
bumper.
Mm-hmm.
Then don't hesitate to get under the car, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bam! I'm under there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hitting the tire. All right, I'm good.
Mm-hmm.
And again, moving the light, moving my head.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where that headlight works good.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use your hands and move
okay.
and then go in there. So same thing in the back.
Mm-hmm.
Also the thing that most people don't realize
mm-hmm.
is the top of a car.
Oh, really?
Everybody puts a mirror underneath the car.
Yeah, with that.
Every time, and this is no joke, every time
mm-hmm.
for about 6 months we were doing threat assessments,
mm-hmm.
we put devices on top of the car.
Oh.
Nobody checks the top of the car.
Uh-huh.
Everybody does the mirror,
uh-huh.
right?
Uh-huh.
Lift the trunk, lift
this
the hood.
This one, so with that, you know.
Right, uh-huh. and they won't look on top of the car.
Mm-hmm.
So this one's easy, right?
Mm-hmm.
We can look, that one you can look, that's easy.
Mm-hmm.
But something like this, so it's a good idea to have a step ladder where you can, or you can step up on the tire and make sure that you check the top
mm-hmm.
of the vehicle for devices that shouldn't be there, wires that come up,
mm-hmm.
or antennas that come in.
Uh-huh. This is a high checkpoint. When I connect the stuff to the vehicle, I will stand to the side and then look into the hand first. It makes you have to do something else, okay? And if you try to something touchy, I have to stop that, okay? And I will tell him, come out slowly.
Okay, turn off the vehicle.
And then don't turn under the engine.
Okay.
Just, you know, show me your two hands. Okay, and unload slowly, and I will check to the he's got to the something remote or what something connection to the house. And then if find the, I will collect the dead one, leave it to the side. Okay, and then back him the standing the
away from,
away from the vehicle, and then I trying to first to watch out to the any wire. Okay, and try to the lock the side because it, this is good space to hiding, and then my job is to find out the unusual. Okay, so old or new, something different or not. Okay, and then if not, okay, I'm not turn on to the engine because I have been leaving to the same condition. Check to the behind the two or the same thing. Okay, and then even to the something package with the tire, to try to check to the dead one. And then of course I keep watching to the have to the connection wire or some else. Okay, and when I to try to the searching to the bottom, I have to the away look to the different angle. Okay, and then especially shadow dark side. Okay, then if not, okay, try looking for the something hiding space, and keep watching the wire connect by somewhere. Actually, you know, like this. Okay, and of course I have to try look at the under, you know, okay, different angle. Okay, and also I have to try to the look at the top. Okay, someone the hiding the bomb at the top. Okay, like that.
Exactly, very good. Excellent. Some of the advanced techniques, you'll learn about different vehicles and what's supposed to be in them and not, right? So especially in the engine, sometimes they have modifications. Range Rovers. Range Rovers have two batteries and lots of equipment in it, right? So if I don't know, I'm like, this is suspicious. So knowing the vehicle is important, what's in there. So in a vehicle, so you know about the people. So you learned earlier today about recognizing signs of people doing it. But you can have, this is an example remote, right? So there's a camera right here. So from the outside, you can't see the camera.
Yes, I cannot see.
With that, however, in here, you can actually see, I can remote control and I can.
Oh, this is connected right to the inside the camera.
Exactly, and I can put this on a watch. There's also a phone app, so I can look like I'm looking at my phone, but I can control the camera. So I can be outside of the car, sitting down, I park my car, looking at the side to something, and now I can control it.
Okay,
see, and there's the image right there that I can see. I can zoom in.
Okay.
I can zoom out. See, I'm zooming in there. I can zoom out. And I can control the image. And then there's also I can do an external microphone here. So I'm still getting a microphone, directional microphone. So there's ways that you can do it. So when you're looking at a vehicle, you also have to look for, you know, are there little cameras in the windows looking out? Right? Same thing with an app. I can do an app to a camera, and I can set the camera up in the back. And I'm controlling it, you know, via that mechanism. So don't just look for people, look for bits of equipment, lenses, microphones. Remember we talked antennas? We'll show you something later today where this, if I park this with an antenna, I collect all the signals. I can take your garage door, your Wi-Fi. So there's electronic surveillance as well. So there's physical, there's remote, and electronic. I can't really see in there, right? It's very difficult. But there, you have a special secret tool. You know what that tool is?
What is it?
Your phone. Watch this. I can't see in there, right? I can't see any cameras. However, if I set up the phone, here we go, on any camera. So this is your video camera, right? So this is your video camera. If you put it up to the glass, look at that.
No tent. See how easy that is? I can see inside. Like there's no tent. Your camera can see inside. So I can see in. I'm not breaking in your car. I haven't gone in your car. I haven't broken in the car. But I can look in the car just like that, and I can see everything, and I can take pictures if I need to. Your camera.
Pretty much, you know, this is new technology.
But it's legal, right? I haven't broken in the car. I've not entered the car, but I can look inside the car if it's tinted.
Yeah, you know, the searching, everything, the stand in the middle, you know, legal or illegal, but the, I have to collect the, you know, evidence, how used that is to the, you know,
exactly.
Legal and illegal.
Exactly, and everybody has a cell phone now, right? So put it on video, do it right in there.
Very good.
It's also good if you don't have a stepladder, you don't want to stand up, you can also do the video up here, right?
Okay.
I can see on top of the car. See if I'm too short. I can put my camera on video, and now I can see the top of the car to search it if there's nothing on top.
I see.
So sometimes a video camera is actually very handy.
Oh, good, good.